He's known as one of the mathematicians with perhaps the most natural talent for maths, and it's a man called Ramanujan. He was an Indian mathematician. He started with no formal training in mathematics, but just by working alone, isolated, he was able to come up with all these mathematical facts, these theorems, all by himself. Some were rediscoveries of things that were already known. Some were new. And he sent these to Cambridge mathematicians, and they recognized his talent. And he was invited to come to Cambridge and show off what he could do. When we're filming this, a film has just come out all about Ramanujan. This film just concentrated on one achievement, and it was something to do with partitions. So partitions is about the number of ways we can break down a number. And we take a number, an integer, and how many ways can we break it down into positive parts? And to prove that I'm a serious mathematician, I'm going to illustrate this by using Duplo here. Let's say we take the number 4 and I've got 4 units of Duplo there. How many ways can I break this down into positive parts? So I could start with this. It's a tower of 4, or I could break it down, right? I could have a 3 and a 1, right? Or I could have a 2, a 1, and a 1. Or I could break it down again. I could have 1, 1, 1, 1. And there is one I've missed there, if you noticed. I have missed out breaking it down into 2 and 2. So in fact, there are 5 ways to break this down. So if we draw this out, we can either draw it like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. We can do a 3 and a 1 like that, 2, 2. We could have 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 like that. So this is what mathematicians actually do. They do it this way because by seeing it as a picture, you can actually make conclusions about partitions which are easier to see. The French do this slightly differently. The French draw them like this. You can have a row of 4 like that. And you can have a row of 3 with a row of 1 like that. So it's slightly the other way around. Or you could do it like this. Bom, bom. There. And then the last one here, 1, 1, 1, 1. So it's a slightly different way of doing it. My favourite footnote from a textbook. Do you have a favourite footnote from a textbook? Oh, no, I do. Favourite footnote from a textbook was by Ian MacDonald, who said, if you want to do the French notation, you should read this textbook while looking upside down and in a mirror. So I get to say this for myself for the first time. If you want to use the French notation, watch this video upside down and in a mirror. So let's look at the sequence of partitions. So the sequence is this. 1, 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 15, 22, 30, 42, and so on like this. Okay, so when we were looking at partitions of 4, that's for this one here. There are 5 partitions of 4. So if that's breaking down the number 4, there are 5 ways of doing it. If you wanted to break down the number 5, there'd be 7 ways of doing it, and so on. So these numbers get larger, and by the time we get to something like 100, right, how many ways could we break down the number 100? If we did that, it's going to be a large number. It's going to be 190,569,292. So these get really large. Now, it becomes very difficult to calculate these partitions by hand. Wouldn't it be nice to have a formula that helps us work out these partitions? So then if I have a formula, you can give me a number and I can tell you how many ways to break that down. Oh, fantastic. And this is the problem that Ramanujan decided to tackle. So there were some formulas before Ramanujan, which go back to Euler. Not particularly pretty formulas, but I could show you what they look like. Should I do that? Okay, so I'm gonna draw out a polynomial using partitions as coefficients. It means it's gonna look like this. 1 plus, I'm gonna have plus x plus, now I'm gonna have x squared next, but I'm gonna use how many ways to break down 2 there, which is 2 ways of doing that. So if I had x cubed next, on how many ways to break down 3? And there are 3 ways of doing that. And now I keep going like this. So if I had x4, we know how many ways to break that down, right? There are 5 ways of doing it. And then it's 7 for x5 and so on like this. So this is a very mathsy looking thing. In other words, if you like this notation, which means sum, if I want to sum, these are called partitions of n, and then it's times x to the power n. There you go. And you do that all the way up to infinity. Now, what Euler saw, well, this was equal to, this is equal to, I'm going to use another symbol here. This symbol, which is a capital pi, means product. It means you're multiplying these things together.
Not 3.14.
It's not 3.14. Yeah, we're limited to how many letters we've got to use. So we're using pi here for product. The product of 1 over 1 minus x to the k. Here we go. We got this is from k equals 1 to infinity. So we've got something that we're multiplying together is equal to this polynomial. So this is a way of working out partitions. And this is what you used to do classically. And so if you want to work out the partitions of 100, you could use a formula like this and actually do the calculation, but it's not particularly easy. But that is what they used to do if they had to do it by hand. And it's what your computer would do if it wants to work out partitions. It would use a formula like that. Ramanujan had an amazing intuition for numbers. Another Cambridge mathematician called John Littlewood said that all the positive integers were Ramanujan's personal friends, which sounds like an utter nightmare to me, having infinitely many personal friends. Imagine the Christmas card list, sounds terrible. So let's have a look at some of the things he noticed about partitions. I guess this is something that attracted him to the subject. We're looking at partitions of, let's say, a number that looks like this, 5k plus 4. Okay, so if you have a number like that, it ends with a 4 or a 9. 4, 9, 14, 19. So these numbers. So if you have a number like that, he noticed something. He noticed that the number of ways of breaking it down is divisible by 5. So there's a fact that he noticed. So if you did, let's do it. So if we took the first example, so if we took k equals 0, we're looking at, if it's 0, looking at partitions of 4, hey, we did that, right? How many ways were there to do it? It was 5 ways of doing it. It's divisible by 5, great. What about partitions of 9? So if you have k equals 1, this would be partitions of 9, that's the next step up. How many ways of doing that? And if you work it out, I can tell you there are 30 ways of doing that. And hey, again, it works, it's divisible by 5, and it always appears to be the case. Ramanujan was able to show this, and then he was able to show a couple of things that were similar to this as well, like if you had partitions of a number that looked like this, 7k plus 5, then that is divisible by 7. Or if you had partitions that looked like this, 11k plus 6, then this is divisible by 11. So we had these little facts, and if you see that pattern, it does seem to appear like the next one should be something like this. Partitions of 13k plus 7 is divisible by 13. And that is not right. That is incorrect. The pattern doesn't hold. Ramanujan found these three, and they found no other formula like this. And they thought, well, that's it. Those are the only formulas we've got. I mean, the next one doesn't hold. The others don't appear to hold. Eventually, 50 years later, they did solve this. There is one that looks like this. It's not as simple as what they thought. 17,303k plus 237 is divisible by 13, which is nothing like what Ramanujan found before. I know it seems crazy, but now we know that we have a formula like this for every prime, but they're just not as nice as the first three that was found by Ramanujan. But this is still not the big formula that they wanted to find. Let's have a look at the big formula, the main punchline. Okay, number of partitions is 1 over 4n square root of 3 multiplied by the exponential of pi. That's your traditional pi. That's 3.14 times the square root of 2n over 3. So it's a nice closed formula for how many partitions there are. That twiddle sign, if you notice, means it's not equals. It means it's an approximation, but it's an approximation that gets better with larger values. So this is actually getting better and better as you go along the sequence. So if we did this with an example, let's do 100, right? We know what the 100 value was. And if we did this with 100, we put 100 in here, we would get 199,280,893. Now, this is in this right area for the true value, but it's about 4.6% off. Maybe it's not the best, but again, this formula is getting better with larger values, but I can do better than that because this formula I gave you here is actually just the first term in a series. So this can actually become more accurate. In fact, it becomes equal. So what Ramanujan was able to do was use his full formula, and he just needed the first five terms to work out the value for partitions of 200 to the nearest integer. And you can actually do that using his own formula. So these are not particularly easy to calculate, but the largest value we've calculated so far is something around 100 million million million. So it's 20 zeros, a massive number. And the number of partitions, so the number of ways of breaking that down, is something that has 11 billion digits. So it's a huge number of ways of doing it. The reason partitions are important, partitions are used in the mathematics of shuffling, like shuffling a pack of cards. Right? So think of a shuffle like that. But there are lots of things in maths that are actually a shuffle. You can think of, even in physics, like shuffling energy. So you know energy isn't created or destroyed, it just gets moved around, right? It just gets shuffled, it gets conserved. And underneath that, the maths is the same. It's the maths of shuffling and it's the maths of partitions.
This is something we call a staircase, 4 and 3 and 2 and 1. Another shape that's kind of interesting, it turns out, for my purposes, is where I have two rows of the same length.
10 to the 68th arrangements of a deck of 52 cards. It's more than the number of particles in the universe. Okay, so one way of defining randomness is to say all arrangements should be about equally likely. I'll say a sort of more practical version of it. Suppose that